Thanks everybody for coming tonight. My name's Kim Lyons. I'm going to be moderating your panel on social media and politics. I want to thank, first of all, Work Hard Pittsburgh for the space and letting us come into their home tonight to have this discussion. Thank Academy Pittsburgh for being our sponsors. And I want to thank all of our guests for being here tonight. Also wanted to let you know this is a production of Podcamp Pittsburgh, which is this year is August 13th and 14th. And if you have an idea for Podcamp Pittsburgh, you should let us know at the website, podcamppittsburgh.org.
.com.
And so I thought what we'd do tonight is we'll have I have a few talking points. We'll go over with our panelists, and then you know we can discuss among ourselves, hopefully a lively discussion, and then we'll open up to some questions for the audience. And we'll try and keep it civil. We're not going to, anyone's political views or their political views, I'm not going to question that. So we'll let those lie. But I think this is a good time of year, especially with the election as it's been going on and the use of social media in ways that we haven't ever envisioned before, to talk about how this is going to impact not just the election, but politics sort of as a whole. So I'm gonna introduce our guests first. Craig Grella is the co-founder and director of One Blue Voice. It's a digital consulting firm in Pittsburgh. He was most recently National Digital Operations Manager of the Bernie 2016 presidential campaign. He helped develop the technical training and organizational structure. Welcome, Craig.
Thank you.
Let's see, DS Kinsel is a Pittsburgh-based creative entrepreneur and arts administrator, co-founder of Boom Concepts in Garfield. For the past 2 years, he has been developing an open source public art project called Hashtags Are the New Protest Signs that exists in public dialogue in the digital space. Graham Reichbaum, for the past 8 years, has authored the government and politics blog, The Pittsburgh Comet, a bit of a thorn in the side to local media in a very good way. He is a self-professed social justice warrior and who likes highlighting the work of others, which is always a good thing. Donald Gilliland is assistant metro editor for breaking news and national politics at the Pittsburgh Tribune Review. Before joining the Trib, he was an enterprise reporter for the Patriot News in Harrisburg, covering Marcellus Shale, prison reform, and government corruption. So welcome our panelists. Thanks everybody for coming tonight. So I'm just going to dive right in. I think the biggest difference we've seen in this campaign is candidates battling out on Twitter. And I'm wondering, you know, I'd like to sort of go down and get your thoughts on who's been most effective in this medium. You know, Donald Trump obviously has a very specific go-to style, very direct, has a lot of loyal Twitter followers. Hillary Clinton has sort of tried to match him in some instances, has not been very successful a lot of the time. She's had some gaffes that were pretty well publicized. And I'm wondering how you feel about their use as, is it effective in swaying voters or in swaying public opinion? And you know, Craig, I know you have some sort of behind the scenes knowledge about this, and I wondered, you know, Graham and I had talked a little bit about not only are the candidates using Twitter to sort of talk to directly to voters or directly to followers, but they're kind of using it to they've used it to sort of rebuke their followers when they do something, sort of surrogates who do things that maybe aren't kosher, you know, that are sort of beyond the pale. And I know there's been some criticism of the quote-unquote Bernie Bros that a lot of people have said, well, a lot of these guys who are very devoted fans of Bernie Sanders have stepped over the line in some cases. And did you feel, you know, running the campaign or being part of the campaign, that you had a responsibility to sort of rein them in a little bit, maybe if they cross the line, or let the public discourse sort of exist outside, separate of the campaign? I mean, and that's sort of a very direct question to you, but I want to sort of ask everyone's take on it. What was your kind of thoughts on that?
We received a lot of feedback from various sources asking us to, in some cases, rebuke the Bernie Bros and other people who one group or another felt had said something, whether it was in the media or in a social media stream. And the campaign, for the most part, kind of kept out of that. Mm-hmm. What was public, and we didn't feel like we needed to regulate what somebody was saying. If they felt like they had a grievance to air, it was their right to air it. I think the campaign made it pretty clear the official channels and the non-official channels. Mm-hmm. And that wasn't to say like, hey, these guys are crazy, it's a non-official channel, so you kind of got to take it with a grain of salt. But
yeah.
If you go back a couple years, I think you have the onset of these social media streams being used for business more and more. And I think you see these groups coming up and maybe even some consultancies taking control of social media streams for candidates. And they're almost being used as mouthpieces. Mm-hmm. I felt in this campaign continuing, and even though some of that is still true, I feel that there's almost the personality of the candidate is definitely reflective in the social media streams. Whether or not that's completely controlled by the candidate himself or herself, or a team of people, which is usually the case these days. Which I think is interesting, especially because you're dealing with these streams that have, you know, between all these presidential candidates, you're talking about 20 million followers. I mean, it's a percentage of the population. So,
do you think that sort of robs it of authenticity to have like a team of people, and how many layers you have to go through before you get that tweet out there? You know,
I think it robs it of authenticity if you claim to be something else.
Mm-hmm.
If you know, I don't think anyone really believes that Donald Trump is tweeting every 3 minutes and responding to 19 different news stories across the globe.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that that's entirely possible in this day and age anymore. So I think when somebody's like Donald Trump, who's tweeting, you know, 10, 15 times an hour and seems to be covering so much, you know, depth and breadth of current news, I don't know that anyone really believes that's him 24/7.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Graham, what are your sort of thoughts on, because we had talked about this a little bit via email. And
I don't know how campaigns are going to deal with this moving forward in the future, because it's a big country. There are hundreds of millions, possibly,
mm-hmm.
of people on social media. Some of them are going to be jerks, and it's going to be really easy for any campaign to sort of pick out,
mm-hmm.
you know, whatever narrative that they want to, whatever negative narrative
yeah.
that they want to feed.
Because once you start policing it, you know, where is the love? Where do you, you know, you're going to sanction this kind of behavior, but not that kind of behavior.
Exactly. And it's smart because it gets the campaign that you're running against off of their message,
mm-hmm.
and it gets them thinking about, well, how do I attack our own fans
yeah.
and adherents?
Right.
Or, you know, how do you rein them in? And it's an impossible task because, you know, can you rein in, maybe if you do a brilliant job, you rein in 95% of
mm-hmm.
your adherence, but there's always going to be that 5% that's
yeah.
out there. You know, maybe, you know, they maybe have anger issues, maybe they're 12 years old, we don't
mm-hmm.
know who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought the Clinton campaign, frankly, was very good at, you know, the first tweets that I saw them picking out of the Bernie Bros,
mm-hmm.
I'm looking at this and I'm like, well, this person has 114 followers.
Right.
This person has 250
right.
followers. Is this really...
Yeah.
Right?
It's a
but
you're
it was,
die on, yeah.
But, you know, it was one of those things that helped work.
Yeah.
So I don't know how we're going to deal with that aspect, particularly going forward. Maybe everyone's going to grow up and, you know, understand the social media is... you know, you're dealing with everyone, and not necessarily everyone is thinking of themselves as a campaign surrogate. They're just
right.
expressing themselves. But for this year, it was pretty good. And I just want to add, as far as the Donald Trump thing, I mean, I had not thought that maybe someone else, that he had a team of people designing those tweets. But obviously, I mean, his use of Twitter was really effective early on in the Republican primary.
Yes.
And I can sort of respect how, I mean, my politics are pretty far from his, but just as a Twitter user, I was like, wow, this guy seems like he's out there.
Yeah.
I feel like
irritant.
I know him.
He got under the skin of his opponents
mm-hmm.
in the Republican primary, for sure. And no one could really match what he was, whatever you think of his politics, no one could match how he was really driving the tone of the debate during those primaries.
And he established what felt like an authentic relationship
mm-hmm.
with the people on the other end, and that's kind of tricky
yeah,
whether it was
sure.
really him or
yeah,
whatever,
sure.
but it was impressive
yeah.
for the time.
Sure. Don, what do you think?
Personally, I think the arguments, the battles between candidates and particularly their followers, I don't find it that interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it certainly can play into a larger narrative, like you were talking about, picking and then building the narrative around it. But from my perspective, and we've covered at the Trib, when Melissa Daniels was there on Slow News Days for
mm-hmm.
our blog, we covered a couple of instances where folk in Harrisburg, you know, some of the staffers, Republican in Dems would get into it on Twitter.
Sure.
And we covered it because it's amusing.
Mm-hmm.
You can
it's kind
see
of a
them,
sideshow.
You know,
it's not really the main
exactly.
story.
Exactly. It's a
yeah.
A sideshow. What I found most interesting about the use of social media in the presidential campaign was how different Donald Trump's use really was. And I think he got a lot more credit, perhaps, than he deserved in terms of being unvarnished, unpolished, you know, this sort of raw
mm-hmm.
voice out there. It was a raw voice, but it was certainly a practiced voice.
Sure.
This
campaign was not the first time
oh,
he had
not at
been
all.
Behaving
and
that. His Twitter feed is
it's
like that for a long time.
It's a tabloid voice.
Sure.
Which arguably, I mean, he was the master of the tabloids back in the
sure.
80s. And arguably, the tabloid voice goes over very well on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what you saw was you saw the more professional campaigns with larger staffs and, you know, I would say the sense of responsibility in messaging,
mm-hmm.
really struggling to try to figure out how to deal with that.
Yeah, sort of contain it and control
the
it.
The bottom line brilliance of it, though, was, from my perspective, was that it was so off. And he was very good at tweeting out things that even many in his party found offensive.
Mm-hmm.
And usually he would walk it back, not always. He would walk it back a couple days later, but in the intervening 2 days, people like me, organizations like mine, and much more to the point, the television stations made it the news cycle.
Right.
And
right.
a tweet, for crying out loud, could control the news cycle.
Sure.
And I don't think the traditional campaigns have come anywhere close to being able to do that, and that's largely because they have avoided the tabloid mentality. He's a master of it.
Mm-hmm, sure.
And I think that's really the new thing that we saw, was that voice coming in unmediated in a way that you really couldn't have done in campaigns past.
Yeah, and I'm less interested in the sort of campaigns getting into it with each other. I'm more interested in when you have that's your sort of leader of the pack, right? When he's setting the tone, then what's the responsibility if you've got, you know, because it's, you know, fairly well known on Twitter, especially, that there's a large contingent of, you know, hostile, just outright, you know, racist, sexist, very pointed discussion that is misogynistic discussion that goes on, irrespective of Donald Trump. But what when that comes into your becomes part of your campaign?
Listen, he retweets some of this stuff.
Sure.
Well,
that becomes news itself.
Yeah.
Yeah, he knows where his audience is.
Certainly does.
Right,
yeah.
And his digital avatar and who he is translates to the audience that you're speaking
mm-hmm.
to, right? That is in the corners of the internet. It's a great place for democracy and freedom of voice and supporting marginalized voices, but it's also a very scary place where those trolls sit in the corner. So if there's a leader, a Democratic, or a leader of some sort of government position that can present those ideals at the top of the food chain,
mm-hmm.
of course they're going to be excited.
Sure.
Of course it's going to create variability of that messaging.
Sure.
I think it's a little bit more nuanced than that, in the sense that I think his audience was people in the media as well. I mean, some of those things, I think, were so calculated to offend the traditional broadcast media,
mm-hmm.
That it was almost a guarantee that, and then
yeah,
it becomes a feedback loop, because once people in the media realized that Trump stories get eyeballs, get clicks,
I mean, look
then
at CNN,
it really became
CNN's ratings.
There was nothing
campaign.
To stop us, if you will,
mm-hmm.
From just going Trump full bore, and it gave him hours and hours and hours of free publicity.
But he also translates the best.
Yes.
If you think about for Hillary, does she translate to Black Twitter? Probably not.
Well, she
right?
had this sort of disastrous
exactly.
hashtag with not my abuela, right?
Right?
When she tried to appeal to as a grandmother, you know, tell us how your abuela is like Hillary, and it backfired.
He's not concerned about those voters, so he doesn't need to translate to them in a digital space.
Right. Yes.
Yeah.
You asked a question about does it translate to voters, and I don't know. I don't know that there is any real research that says, you know, a 4 million fan base on Facebook translates to 2,000 votes.
Right.
I don't know that exists, and I don't. I, I can tell you that, you know, on a presidential campaign, things move so quickly, mm-hmm. and there are so many things happening that you, even while you're analyzing data and looking at trends, you almost don't have time to stop and say, wow, we sent out this great tweet, maybe we'll get 15 votes. That never enters the conversation.
Yeah.
But I can tell you one of the things that I did see this year, and this may be prompted by the news media, maybe prompted by, I certainly saw this in the social media streams, was fact-checking, which was huge this year. And I think that trickled into, we saw this recently with Anderson Cooper interview, but it happened in journalistic media and written media. It happened in certainly, I can remember, this was a very big issue on the Bernie campaign where Donald Trump had tweeted that climate change is a hoax perpetrated by the Chinese to thwart our business endeavors. Now, whether you agree with human impact of climate change or not, I think we can agree it's probably not a Chinese hoax one way or the other. And that
it's
was
been established science since the 1970s.
No matter where you stand on the issue, I think that was refuted pretty easily, and that conversation took place on Twitter. You have conversations very similar to that happen in all these campaigns. And while it is true, I think some of this stuff played out for a day or two and became this news cycle. Ultimately, the fact-checking and disputes came back as well, which was very interesting to see. And I think whether it was influenced by that or influenced from it, you see this almost pushback by the news media in terms of asking questions and asking serious questions and following up and saying, well, you didn't answer my question.
Right.
Maybe you want to do it now.
Right.
I think there was more of that this year or in this cycle than there had been in the past. And I think that maybe is fueled by the ability or the availability of so much fact-checking.
Yeah.
You mean fact-checking because effectively when someone puts out a bogus tweet, the truth is crowdsourced.
I mean, if you're Donald Trump and you have 9 million followers on Twitter and you have 8 million followers on Facebook, that's 17 million people. That's, you know, 5% of the population, right? You can pop out a tweet, and if enough people pick up on it and the news picks up on it, that's almost fact. And then you're having people basically having these Twitter wars saying, like, well, that's not necessarily true. And another one comes to mind is, and this is almost like a platitude. It was Hillary Clinton saying to Bernie Sanders, where were you when we were waging this war on healthcare? And the campaign responded very quickly with a picture of Bernie Sanders literally standing behind her.
Yeah,
as she's, you know, so like, there was a lot of that. There was a lot of this back and forth and you know, putting out a campaign statement, putting out some quick quip or a platitude, and then backed up by, hey, here's what really happened.
And everyone has access to the RCAP.
Right,
so that not only can you push the facts from a academic source, but you can find that picture online and presenting it in a visual narrative.
I think that, and this will be quick, I think that Trump proved that his outrageous tweet shtick is very effective if you want to stand out in a 16-candidate field, get a leg up, especially in an audience that at that time is not that interested in fact-checking. They're interested in who has the personality to take it to someone. I think we're starting to see that his shtick is not working as well in the general, because he's getting so much attention.
It's all on him now. It's not diffused among other people.
Right. It's just old.
Yeah. Well, one topic that I do want to touch on as far as social media, D.S. Kinsel has done... his theory is that hashtags are the new protest signs. This has been a presentation that you've done. And I really like this sort of thinking of this as a way of, you know, sort of taking this medium that's associated with advertising and marketing. You know, you hashtag your Twitter chat, or you hashtag the, you know, the new product that you're promoting. But this lets social movements spread to a much larger audience and gives them a way to sort of control, steer the narrative, you know, in these... for marginalized groups, maybe, that don't have this mainstream media access. So maybe you could talk a little bit about how you've kind of formulated this idea. I think the one that springs to mind for me most, and probably for most people, you know, a protest taking the form of hashtag is probably Black Lives Matter.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe we could talk a little bit about how that evolved and how other sort of maybe lesser known but just as significant protests have kind of has that been the blueprint for some of these protests? Is that going to sort of be the sort of touchstone for this is how you really organically build something?
Yeah, like Black Lives Matter, Bring Back Our Girls.
Mm-hmm.
What are some other things? Feel the Burn, if you want to think about just like
specific
political
language.
It allows people to translate their ideas, but also it's a space where we're all engaged. It's like a global town hall space. So you guys talk about those numbers or the amount of followers, but really seeing that not only as a hashtag, as a protest sign, but thinking about how, what are the intersections of advocacy, activism, and advertisement within a hashtag so you can communicate your ideas to a broader audience. So if you're thinking about Black Lives Matter, being centered in police brutality and that message of police brutality against marginalized people and Black and brown people, and how it has grown to include more stories, also providing the point of advocacy a digital archive to stand on so people can reflect. And when it does reach a traditional news source or traditional media source, there can be some fact-checking. You can give some parenthetical notation to the voices that were active from the beginning, which happens so often once things reach a traditional media outlet.
Yeah, and I think you touched on something. You know, the Feel the Burn was not a product of the Sanders campaign. It was an organic, you know, kind of followers and fans and devoted to potential voters for Bernie Sanders. They came up with this organically. I think those tend to be the ones that have the staying power. Like the ones that brands devise, they can go off the rails so easily. You pick the wrong hashtag, and you know you someone co-opts it and sort of drives it in an entirely different direction than you intended. But the ones that organically grow, the ones that organically come to be, do they serve, you know, a candidate like Bernie Sanders when you have a Feel the Burn? I feel like the campaign capitalized on that, but not in a way that was kind of overly gross or overly, you know.
It's like trying to pick your own nickname.
Yeah,
you know, it's like,
right.
You know, no. Nobody wants to give you the nickname that you want. We sit around and we talk about certain things. I mean, there's definitely an effort to try to encapsulate your message in as succinct as possible way, if you can do that. But it doesn't always work out that way. It doesn't always work out that way. You hope that the message itself carries, but you are looking for ways to connect with certain groups, and sometimes that's done through hashtags and certain marketing. But it's not something that you sit around and you spend a ton of time on. Like, let's plan this hashtag for 6 hours, and it's going to be great, and put it on every piece of marketing material. You know, in the case of Feel the Burn, it went on T-shirts and mugs, but that was very much after the fact.
Right.
And that was not something like, hey, let's have this slogan and let's slap it on everything. So there is definitely a little bit of planning. I do think that this raises something that, in my mind, is something more interesting with the state of social media. And it's using social media as a testing ground. You know, traditionally, you would have politicians who would put a poll in the field at great expense and have somebody getting response from people, whether it be it a return mail or the phone, and tens and hundreds of thousands of dollars. And I think the very savvy campaigns are now starting to transition into using social media as a testing ground, not only for issues, but in some cases even response to platform issues. And when you get a response or a certain response in social media, you can very quickly pivot and translate that into something that has a wider appeal throughout your marketing channels and even in some of your issue-based content. That to me is very interesting, using social media as a means to kind of test a national conscience.
Do you think that eventually sort of supplants traditional polling? Because I think we've seen so much polling this cycle, you know, and it's hard to know which ones are authentic, which ones are half, you know, they've been sort of proven wrong a lot of times in some of the primaries that we've seen. But, you know, when you have a good scientific poll backed up by, you know, data that's supported and done in a mindful way, you know, that does carry some weight still with a lot of voters. Do you see social media supplanting that? Do you think it just becomes part of a larger way of...
It becomes a tool in the toolbox.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, you know, a poll done really well that engages somebody and is asking questions that people want to answer, it's always going to be valuable. Knocking on a door is always going to be valuable.
Mm-hmm.
Having a conversation with your neighbor is always going to be valuable. And you're limited. And we talked about trolls. You know, I mean, it's tough because you do, you run into this in email and social media and Facebook, and, you know, I don't think it replaces it, but I definitely think it becomes a tool in a toolbox.
What do you think?
Not to throw water on that conversation, but I'm a little bit, no, I'm not a little bit, I'm uncomfortable.
Go for it, don't be
talking
a little bit.
About feel the burn, which essentially is a marketing slogan, in the same breath as Black Lives Matter. They are too fundamentally different.
I would agree. I would say the only reason that I brought the comparison because they arose organically. They were not
sure.
Driven by a market. They came from a specific group that was, had a stake, had some skin in the game.
Sure.
So
and I think the political longevity of Black Lives Matter is completely different than the marketing of Feel the Burn. And I think the... If you look at Black Lives Matter with some of the other social justice hashtags that have been out there and have been famous for a day or two,
mm-hmm.
I think what you see as a key difference is Black Lives Matter connects with real experience of real people across the country on a number of different levels. And I don't think you can discount the importance of social media to the creation, the genesis of Black Lives Matter.
Sure.
And the videos that didn't exist 10 years ago.
Sure.
I mean, that is a fundamental political shift in American culture. I happen to think it's for a good thing.
Absolutely.
I think that the transparency that results from common people having the video capability on their phone, gives an objective verification to citizen witness that it didn't have before. And it's a verification that cuts through the prejudices of race that in the past have really privileged the establishment narrative.
Sure.
And that's changing, and that's a big thing.
I would agree, definitely.
You wouldn't even have said that 5 years ago.
No.
But so Black
Lives
Yeah. So the reason why I brought up those three hashtags in particular, Feel the Burn was definitely like your fluffy light.
Yes.
But those
yes.
are the three
Feel
hashtags that my students know
uh-huh.
and talk about
yes.
with me on the same level. You know what I mean? Those are the hashtags that the youth, and we were talking about audience, and I mean they can't vote, but the perception and the education and the ability to check the archive and see the intersections between those three levels of language, three levels of messaging, and how do they connect. So saying that those three hashtags are playing ground, and I really appreciate you saying those facts, but that's like when I speak to my youth, and those are young Black youth that are living in this neighborhood, living in the East End, like those are three that they can come off of their tongue really easily. And I think that does speak to like how it is an advertisement, but I mean, I see Black Lives Matter slogans on T-shirts.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
And I don't know where those, and I don't know where those resources are going to,
just
like
yeah, yeah,
you
yeah.
guys don't know where those resources are going to. And it's a question that every hashtag movement, every movement that starts in a digital space that doesn't start in someone's basement or in a church basement, right? Or in a war room somewhere, everything that starts on a digital space, how much creative lockdown do you have
mm-hmm.
when the message spreads? Like for an artist, you know, once your artistry goes to a certain level, you
yeah.
cannot control what the interpretation
mm-hmm.
is. So some may take it to a more commercial route in an advertisement sense, and some may keep it true to the original messaging of it in an activist sense.
Well, not even the interpretation. When it gets to social media,
yeah.
you're done.
Yeah.
Once it's out there,
mm-hmm.
yeah, forget the copyright.
Which
That's...
was kind of an unfortunate thing, I think, about Feel the Burn, which was, I think it was intended as, like, Feel the Burn for economic justice, Feel the
yeah,
Burn.
Yeah, right.
Is
Carry
that,
the torch.
It seemed as though a certain number of Bernie contingent decided it was more like, well, if I say something snarky in a put-down on someone's Facebook page,
<It's a burn.
laughs> I can hashtag it Feel the Burn, like,
yeah.
oh, I just burned you.
Yeah.
That wasn't particularly helpful.
Yeah.
Well, I'm willing to admit when that happened.
And that's the thing that you don't have that control. You know,
yeah,
it's
no.
a good organic, it's got some momentum, but ultimately you don't really have control over it. And that, I think, is what is problematic, especially when you've got something as serious as Black Lives Matter.
Yeah.
The only thing I would add to that is that I'm also uncomfortable giving hashtags and social media too much credit for what's taking place. It's sort of like the Arab Spring was really hyped as, you know, I think more of a marketing ploy than reality. The key to the longevity of Black Lives Matter, in addition to the technology that we have that we didn't before, is also people interrupting their routines and actually going out and speaking and protesting. And it's also different generations communicating amongst one another. Mm-hmm. That has nothing to do with the hashtag. The hashtag facilitates it.
Yes.
Yeah.
But it doesn't cause it.
Yes.
Right. Yeah.
No, yes.
I would agree.
So in the project, and that's usually like the ending communication to the project, hashtags are the new protest signs. If this cannot replace action, activity, dialogue,
right.
exchange.
Slapping your hashtag on your tweet doesn't equal
it. Doesn't, right? And it activates the conversation about, okay, what do you do next? So you've done action. We have these great computers in our hand now, right? Everyone has that, which we didn't have before.
Right.
So you're talking about the archive, being able to document, being able to record things. So just being able to document that action when information would have to be passed hand to hand, right? You think about Black codes. We've always used hashtags, you know, in a form of conversation, right? It's the evolution of activism. It's the evolution of, you know, freedom activity.
One of the ones, and this is relates that we didn't mention yet, was maybe my favorite hashtag so far was "criming while white," because I mean that came along during the Black Lives Matter movement, and people forget the original purpose of hashtags was it was like a link you could click to see what everyone
so
else
you had
is
a
saying
common
about.
Thread
mm-hmm.
along
that
was
hours and hours of infotainment was clicking on that "criming while white" just to see what people's confessions were, and that was sort of like I thought it was sort of like an authentic use of the hashtag, like let's actually see what other people are saying, and you know get inspired by how many people are using it. All of a sudden, I thought that was an interesting moment in the movement.
Yeah, for sure. Graham, you and I had talked a little bit during the email about how the role of bloggers in this campaign season has been very different than maybe it was 4 years ago or 8 years ago, and how you can talk a little bit about this, but how maybe mainstream media has come sort of back around to impugning bloggers or their motives or what have you. More than they had perhaps 4 years ago or 8 years ago. And maybe you could talk a little bit about that as a blogger, how you've sort of seen that come around.
Well, first of all, like Facebook especially kind of stole bloggers' thunder an awful lot because everyone has this publishing platform. You don't have to set out to be a blogger.
Yeah, you don't have to pay for your hosting. You don't have to buy a URL.
You don't have to give yourself a new identity.
Right.
You're just online already, so you're just saying what you mean. That stole our thunder a little bit. But then there's also like, when I came up about 8 or 9 years ago, it was really, it seemed like a relief that there were other people besides the media, you know, using their own authentic voices, coming up with their own ideas and their analysis, and people sought that out. It was like, ooh, there's regular people
it's
out
counter.
Here. Thing.
Yeah,
counterculture. This was the first year that I sort of felt like the corporate model really kind of caught up, that there was enough resources behind it, there were enough people trying to write for a slate or any of the other ones that what have you, that, you know, I'm now even reading on Reddit, which I think is, you know, one of the top three sites, people are referring to personal blogs as like, ew, why would you read those kind of it felt like I was left in the lurch for the first time ever because these other content providers, whether they're from campaigns or from, you know, basically reporters doing what is often unpaid work for them online, are sort of like, okay, they're kind of providing what I used to feel like only I could provide. So I've been sort of working on like, okay, well, what's my niche now?
Yes. What can you provide maybe these, so how do you, maybe we don't know the answer to that question.
I mean, my only answer to that is that like, the national scene is kind of saturated, overly saturated, and the local or even state scene is something that's like, well, the resources still aren't there for that.
Yeah.
So I can at least, you know, maybe I need to kind of keep my head down and, you know, you stick to my level until the next thing comes along. That's, but I'm still looking.
Yeah. Don, what do you still have some thoughts on that?
Well, the thing you obviously have is your voice. And voice counts, voice has always counted, but it counts a lot more now in the cacophony. If you have a particular voice that strikes a particular chord in Pittsburgh or in Pennsylvania, and you have the time and wherewithal to do a little bit of research to back that voice up,
that's
and that's
always the,
that's always the trick. I think that's the key. The basic research, so the facts are there, so that the corporate folk aren't going to come and say, well, look, he can't get his facts straight, and then the voice. Because the bloggers are able to exercise freedom of voice in a way that traditional media really aren't. Now, that's beginning to change. If you look at Penn Live in Harrisburg, Penn Live went all digital in 2013, and in essence, they got rid of their editorial class. The reporters post directly to the web, unmediated by any editors, until it gets traction or someone calls in and complains, and then the editor goes and looks and sees what's going on. But oddly enough, it works. It's horrifying to be a reporter in that situation, because unless you write really clean copy, essentially you're crowdsourcing your copy editing, and that can be really embarrassing in the comments section. but there's a level of freedom, and Penn Live allows a certain latitude of voice in their news stories. And I think they've discovered that having the facts straight, but also a particular voice, actually increases the traffic to the stories. Reporters are developing followings within Harrisburg readership that they didn't develop previous to 2000.
But to what end? Because that's the thing that, you know, as a reporter, as a freelance reporter, to what end are you developing that audience? And I guess that's really sort of the question that you have to be able to answer if you're going to, well, why am I, what's my goal with developing this audience?
Well, from my perspective, sure. having worked in that context, the goal ultimately was to make sure that the best information was out there for your readers.
Well, ideally, but for a lot of reporters and for a lot of media personalities, it gets to be how many Twitter followers do I have, and how much, you know, how much. I think
and
you,
that,
you
and
get,
that comes
it
down to how does your company count? Penn Live, when I was there, and I think still, pays very close attention to the number of views your story gets. And there are two big things that factor into that. First, the quality of the story itself, and secondly, the nature of the comments that come below it. And everyone has a hiss of intake and breath here. One of the interesting things about commenting, the reporters in Harrisburg are required, it's in the job description, have to go into the comments section and interact
so you gotta wait
with
in.
The readers, which
so,
takes an inordinate amount of time and
well,
patience.
I mean, how are they moderated?
They have a whole team of moderators.
Okay.
As a department.
looking like crazy. But what happens is when the reporter goes in and begins to interact with the commenters, the level of crazy drops dramatically because they suddenly realize there's a real person in the sandbox paying attention and interacting with them.
Yep.
And it really works. It doesn't work every time. But I'd say 80% of the time, all of a sudden they realize, wait, this isn't this nameless, sort of faceless person behind the print product. This is actually somebody who, if I ask a question, might answer it.
Yep.
And it works. It's really hard on the reporters because, I mean, I remember there were times at 1:30 in the morning I'm engaging in the comments section. But you know, my stories consistently had really good numbers. Part of that was because I had really good beats. But there was no question, if you looked at the comments to stories that I didn't get into compared to the comments to the stories I did, the comments where I got in and interacted with folk were always of a much higher gauge of dialogue. Mm. And it gives the reporter the opportunity to put more information out there and sometimes to explain the context of some of the stuff that is further up in the story. It actually does further the goal of getting the good information out there.
As a reporter, though, I think it's a little bit of a different animal depending on what you are covering, on, you know, for a female reporter, for a reporter of color, for, you know, that's a very tricky proposition to require them to wade into what may be a very,
not so much,
you know,
on the comment
vitriolic
section as from what I've seen in my experience, oftentimes, and I watched it several times in Harrisburg, someone would begin to attack the reporter, and other commenters would come to the reporter's defense. Mm-hmm. Previously, that would never happen. But once there was engagement, they felt like they knew the reporter.
Think about if you are a black or brown reporter, and the comment section doesn't necessarily talk about you, but it begins to talk about your culture, your identity. And you have to wade
in some really vile ways.
Wade into that comment section, which is extremely difficult.
Putting a lot of responsibility on that person.
Putting a lot of responsibility on that person. I mean, you asked to what end? I mean, you know, these institutions have never been an opportunity for marginalized people, for women, for black and brown writers, for different folks. So in this era of independent artists, boutique experiences, I think the end is up to you. Mm-hmm. You know, the writer, the whoever is producing content, and nothing beats quality content.
Yeah.
And I think the great thing about the digital era is you get to respond directly with your audience, whether it be in a digital platform on social media, whether it's in the comment section, you do get to respond directly. And, you know, you are able to navigate between different institutions, so maybe you have to go there for a small while and wade through, but after a few years, you've hopefully built up your audience and your independent platform to not have to put yourself through that. I could not imagine that. And I think about the comment section in this region.
Uh-huh.
It's absolutely, it's horrifying.
Yeah.
You know, it's horrifying.
And this region is not alone.
Yeah, we know that. But I mean, this is Alabama, the North.
Part of what frustrates me about that is that, like, there's a, the phrase that goes around now is, you know, never read the comments.
Right.
So it's you have to.
You have
but there's
to.
Such a, like, the progressive types will just kind of have it ingrained. Like, well, these comments are cesspools.
Yes, these are beneath.
So I'm not
going to
get involved.
Right.
What does that leave things
but
to?
I think you can be aware of the comments and read the comments without having to go, you know, elbow to elbow, or, like, you know, you get in there.
I have a quick suggestion for that. I don't. This is not a problem as much that I confront, and I agree that, like, the comment section is like gardens, and you have to weed your garden. And when it comes to stuff like really ugly misogyny and racism, like, there's a delete key too. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've generally found you hit delete and then say comment was deleted because.
But as a media organization, as a media outlet, what point are you censoring?
I'm going to push back right now
because
censorship is misused in this country more and more.
Mm-hmm.
And bottom line, censorship is about the government stepping in and preventing people from publishing. When you're talking about an individual news organization that's a private institution, mm-hmm. and cutting out the comments is not censorship. It's weeding the garden. And in this age, it's easy enough to go out and start publishing your own stuff.
Yeah.
Go do it.
Yeah, I guess I would respectfully disagree. I think it does border on censorship, and I think that it does. You start down a slippery slope. You have a response. You've offered this platform for people to come in, and you're going to tell them, you know, if you're going to start deleting tweets,
you lay out
start,
the rules.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I guess we'll have to.
What's the action? I mean, I'd like to hear
I started my professional career several years before companies like Google you know, and companies like that. So before blogs and before you would go to a search engine and look up, you know, election news or something like that. You didn't go to a website unless you knew the domain name.
Right. Yeah.
Or you knew somebody who worked there and you would look them up. So it's been interesting, and I've blogged for a long time. I think at one point you would certainly have the traditional media thumbing their nose at the bloggers. Mm-hmm. And then at some point, the traditional media started to buy the blogs. You know, they started,
yeah.
Hey, these are things we can monetize. These are things that we can integrate into our companies,
right.
which I thought was interesting. But there's definitely, for me, I'll just say this flat out. I think without the press in many of its forms, we are lost as a society. We are lost. Blogs aside, and there are some extremely smart bloggers, there are some well-optimized, monetized blogs, but for a large part, your traditional media, journalists are people who have degrees in journalism. They've studied writing, they've studied reporting, things like this. These are, of course, you might just have a few smart people who do it really well, and you definitely have a few bloggers who write extremely well, and maybe they're not steeped in a journalistic background. But I think there are people who have made careers out of this who are providing a valuable service to the public that you can't discount, regardless of how easy it is to or how cheap it might be to run a blog. I think journalists sometimes have a real tough job because you talk about looking at, you know, your boss is maybe looking at eyes. You know, 15 years ago, you wouldn't go look for TechCrunch or TechNerati, things like that. You got the newspaper and that was that. Today, you have to look at how many comments you have on your traditional news story, even though you're being reviewed in a way that maybe is not your traditional media. So it's a very tough spot. I think where we start blurring lines is where we get into things. And there was a real interesting Fox News segment, which I thought was real interesting. And I want to say it was Hannity who was moderating, and it was an independent panel, and it was a guy from the Wall Street Journal, it was Hannity, a Fox News anchor, it was somebody from the Dow Jones, and it was somebody from a newspaper, an editor from a newspaper in London. And when you peel back the surface of this, they were all News Corp employees. So you start to wonder, like, well, how independent is that independent panel? I think that's the dangerous side of the media, and that certainly doesn't exist across the board. I think your initial question was, and I may have missed a little bit of this, but you know, do blogs replace some of that? Do they get seen as an equal to journalism? I'm not sure. There's a lot of great information in blogs, and there are some fantastic bloggers. I think we still rely on the press, and we would be foolish as a society to discount independent investigative journalism.
Yeah, I don't, I mean, I don't know if I speak for all bloggers in this, but I mean, I've always sort of seen my role as, you know, if I get it together, I get some free time to do some independent investigation. Mm-hmm. That's great, that can be a lot of fun. For the most part, I'm out there hyping up professional journalist work, mm-hmm. making sure that other demographics than the one who typically read the mainstream media see it. And then saying, you know, the great thing about journalism, you know, yeah, they can provide high quality information. So it's very tricky for them to suggest to people how they should feel about information or how they should synthesize it with last week's story. And I know a few journalists who are very clever at that, and I love them. But for the most part, it's sort of like, well, we're taking it from there. We're like, okay, they've provided all this stuff, but you know,
why
you should probably get mad
that?
About this,
yes.
And
yeah.
I'll tell you why.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's more symbiotic than competitive.
And most of the bloggers I know are classically trained and have the degrees,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
and have the unpaid
happy.
Internships,
mm-hmm.
and have the followership, and have the Snapchat responses, and there's just a lot of difficulty for them to break into traditional media spots,
yeah.
along with traditional media changing and responding to what they've been working on, you know. So I don't think it's any less of professionalism. I think it's just the evolution of what it means to report. Because yeah, you're right. Without the media, we'd be lost. It's their responsibility to document, to provide interpretation, to give us, you know, behind investigative work, but also the fluff, you know? But it's just the, and this is in every sector, like the sector itself is changing in response to technology. And no one, and it's also bringing all the sectors together, but no one can understand how, because even, you know, visual arts, we're responsible for reporting these things now with more responsibility, you know?
To me, this is a huge issue, and it's an issue that we're gonna have to deal with moving forward, because it's one of transparency, and where do you get your news from, and who do you trust? And I think, regardless of whether it's coming from a blog or if it's coming from Fox News or CNN, you have to be cognizant of where that network's money comes from.
Sure.
I think you have to understand where that network has ownership, and I think you need to understand even the personal views of the anchors and the people presenting the story. Not to say that everyone is duplicitous, that's not what I'm saying, but I think there's a filter there, especially as the personality gets bigger and bigger and more influential. I think there's a little bit of a filter, and it's neither right nor wrong. I think you just need to understand that filter when you're consuming that media. But I think this will be a big issue moving forward in terms of where you get your sources, where you get your information from. We had an interesting experience on the Bernie campaign where we were doing some phone banking. We were calling people in Iowa, Oklahoma, and very rural places that they might only have access to a local newspaper. Mm-hmm. And we're having conversations with them, and they're asking us questions that are verbatim off of a Fox News segment. Well, mm-hmm. You know, what are you going to do about this? And you know that's a talking point. And you don't want to be rude. This is a citizen, so you have to understand where they're coming from. And I think you have to answer questions truthfully and honestly, and that's really all you can do. But you also have to understand that there are people out there who are only getting their media from certain sources, right or wrong, and that does, that influences people's opinions and how they translate that into whether they get involved in a movement or don't get involved in a movement. So it, in my opinion, it's a major issue that we have to deal with.
We've seen, I think, in the last, I could be overstating it, but in the last 10 years, a real increase in self-selection of news sources.
And I think
now,
Facebook has fed that in a way.
In rural areas, not so much, because you're right, the options are limited. Mm-hmm. But if you've got cable, particularly on the internet, I think there's a tendency, and I could be wrong, I haven't seen the numbers, but I get the feeling that there's a balkanization, where people are simply going to news sources that sort of echo what they want to hear. And I think there needs to be a discussion about our responsibilities as citizens to challenge ourselves by different views and different news sources. And I think that conversation is something that should happen as in the terms of what your citizens' responsibilities are.
To be an informed voter, to be an informed part of the country.
Yeah, rather than just take it easy and, you know, get all riled up, to really think about it. That's another conversation.
Sure. I know we're getting short on time, we're getting close to the end of our segment, but I wanted to open up and see if there's any questions from the audience, of our panelists, or of me, or anything that we've talked about that you think we should be, you know, go back to. I want to give the opportunity, please.
You had said that, you know, waiting for the comments as a female journalist is somehow problematic, and I was just wondering why it's more problematic.
I think it's, I don't know if it's more or less problematic, I think it's different. I think you're more subject to personal attacks, that you're more, my experience personally was not as bad, but I had several experiences where it was communicated to me that you don't belong in this space. That, you know, you are in somehow infringing on a space that really is not your space. That this is a space for men to discuss this, or for, you know, this, your opinion in here is not as valid. And it was not in a way that was overtly violent or otherwise threatening to me, but I know of, you know, I have female colleagues who have had that, you know, very directly, you know, where they'll have someone, they'll get into an argument, you know, on an issue or something they've written about, and it escalates into, you know, looking up their home phone number or their address and getting very, very personal in a very scary way. And so I think knowing that that's a possibility as your experience as a female reporter, that does make you guarded. And it does make me, you know, I have a sort of active Twitter feed. I try to be engaging. I try to be, you know, communicative with people. But I am a little, you know, I think twice before I say something that I think might be possibly perceived the wrong way. And you don't like to self-censor, but I think in a lot of ways it's an act of self-preservation. And unfortunately, that sort of fear of the potential that you know this is out there, this has happened to people that you know, it does temper your response or sort of maybe temper your interaction just from that.
Which skews the playing field because as a white guy, you talked about maybe you think twice, like I'm lucky if I think once. Like, I don't care about putting my stuff out there. But that really, I mean, that just changes the whole dynamic.
Yeah.
In my experience, people feel much more comfortable putting down a woman than being racist.
Yeah.
And in my experience, I've seen it less in the comments section than on Twitter. And that experience is, now that's not to say that it doesn't get ugly in the comments section, but that experience goes to, I work with Sarah Ganim on the Penn State coverage. The stuff that came at her, it was unspeakable.
Mm-hmm.
And violent.
Certainly.
Anna Orso was one of our, she was an intern at the Trib, then she worked at the Patriot, and she was the Patriot's reporter in Penn State, based in Penn State her senior year. She was working part-time. She had an experience where she tweeted something out, it was legitimate news, and the response to her was swift, extraordinary, and vile, to the point that I was on the phone with her, walking her through the safe ways to get home.
Yeah.
Then we had an incident here in Pittsburgh when Megan Guza got pushed by policemen at the Trump rally, and the stuff that came at her was from all over the country, and you don't want to have to read that stuff.
Yeah,
and that was a small incident.
There's definitely a little bit of this voyeuristic attitude still in social media where people make comments and they don't believe that they're held to the same standards.
Standard.
The legal, you know, people make comments, and we saw this on the campaign, people making way beyond being a troll. I mean, comments where these people think they're funny until the Secret Service knocks on their door and asks about a certain comment.
They will go into your Facebook pages, they will Google the hell out of you, and then come at you in a very public way. And in some instances, just lying. They'll make stuff up.
Yeah. And I think Twitter facilitates that in a way.
Up. It's horrifying.
And Twitter facilitates that because it has this anonymous layer. Mm-hmm. You know, Facebook, at least you're somewhat accountable because, for the most part, it's your name. Not always, but for the most part.
There was an issue on Facebook maybe 2 weeks ago, and the question was whether Facebook should give warnings to its users that it was going to remove certain news things from their feed or make others prominent. And to be honest, I don't know the whole argument, but there's not a whole lot of moderation on the corporate side of things. You have all of these social media channels have a way in which you can flag a comment.
Yeah.
You know, this is racist, this is sexist, this is this. And it's reviewed and removed. And I think I've seen some instances where I have flagged things that I was a commenter on. I was the third party saying that is way over the line. And I report things like that all the time.
Yep.
And sometimes they're removed and sometimes they're not. But I know, you know, you try to find that policy on Facebook, good luck.
Yeah.
Try to find that policy on Twitter, good luck.
Yeah.
There's a really, I just want to tell you, there's a really interesting, because this happens a lot with women who are sportscasters.
Yes, very much so.
So there are like some highly documented cases.
Talk about a space where women aren't welcome.
Yeah. And, you know, like people reading mean tweets on Jimmy Kimmel. They did an interview where it was a woman sportscaster, and it was a man reading these mean tweets.
To
and
her
the
face.
Men started crying. And this was not even in response to a story This was just a general attack
on,
you know, who they are. So, you know, if you are the minority within your sector and, you know, if you think about traditional news sectors, who's run it, who's created these institutions, you know, the anonymity of the internet and the ability to create an avatar. And there are tools to create multiple avatars to send attacking messages to one person.
Yeah.
I also think there's... Oh, sorry, you've been... Go ahead.
Yeah. Some of you mentioned that there's a kind of like brain trust that edits these comments or takes really offensive ones out. When I hear
brain
about
trust
the stack that offensive tweet and offensive messages that these...
Those are primarily on Twitter.
Okay.
So there's no control over that.
Oh, so they are...
Yes.
In the comments section, something different.
I'm worried that if it's all being edited out, that we're not... People who aren't paying attention, who need to pay attention, aren't seeing the violence of what the trolls are doing. You know what I'm saying?
Some ways,
need to out the trolls so
that
the regular people can see
them.
And we need to protect the users.
The process is different from company to company.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But generally, there's a warning process of, yo, we just took this down... You need to go back and reread the rules.
Right.
And if you break them again, we're just going to disable you. And usually, people who do that, most of them in my experience are trained journalists, and they have a real First Amendment passion.
Yes.
And so they tend
they'd
to
rather
really analyze
have
it.
The argument.
Yes.
They'd rather
have it up there.
To the point where you
what
can
only
allow
gets
it.
Taken out is the stuff that's just... outrageous.
Yeah,
but I've heard that there's a difference between, you know, what you might see a lot of mansplaining going on Facebook.
Really?
But then...
not that much mansplaining right now.
I'm shocked. Tell me more.
But then there's this whole other
this stuff,
genuinely vile avenue.
If it were painted on a wall,
that's
a bridge...
That's exactly what I was about to say.
Yeah.
There would be charges and it would be sand blasted off or water blasted off within hours.
Because the internet is the wild, wild west.
Who's going to...
Well, that's what I'm
who do you go to then? Who do you
who
call
do
you the police?
To,
you call the conservative police?
And,
right, and that's... You're asking a good question.
Speech. It's just offensive.
Yeah.
But giving oxygen of publicity can kill offensive speech in the way we see it when...
I would rather... If someone is in the comment section calling me a nigger, I would rather that comment be taken down before... 1,000 other black people see that comment and say yay or nay, or 1,000 other white people see that comment and say, hey, that's wrong.
Because
or someone says, hey, I like that.
It does.
I like that.
I
agree.
And, that's
like,
and I
no.
think the other responsibility that news organizations have that I fought for sort of as a lonely voice when I was at the Post-Gazette was, you know, we have a responsibility to the people we're writing about.
Yep.
And unfortunately, within the Post-Gazette comment section, and I'm not singling out the Post-Gazette, this is a universal problem. The stories that would get the most vile comments were stories that had anything to do whatsoever with race. When the situation with Wilkinsburg High School, with Duquesne High School, whenever there was a situation that involved, particularly for some reason, black children, the comment sections were absolutely vile, absolutely the worst kind of racist, feedback you can imagine.
Even positive news.
Oh, there would be a way to say, well, they shouldn't have been in that neighborhood, or they, you know, to make the comment that wasn't overtly using an epithet, but was pretty clear what they were talking about. And so my argument was, we have responsibility to the people we are writing about to shield them. We shouldn't be giving people a platform to come in and attack people we are writing about. You know, I felt more strongly about that than, for the most part, journalists can kind of thick skin, you can kind of handle, you know, a certain level of disdain. I mean, look, Donald Trump, you know, calls us horrible people, and, you know, we're awful, we're terrible, whatever. You build up a resistance to that. My feeling was, we have a responsibility to the people who are writing about, in the community at large, to not allow, to not provide a platform where people can come in and contribute this kind of...
And that was, in my experience, and just real quick, there were a number of times at Penn Live when I went in specifically defending the subject of the story.
Sure.
To my recollection, they were always adults. But, you know, expecting them to go into the comment section particularly on a good news story, that is a little much.
Yes.
And so I would go in and push back.
Yeah, and I think...
And that usually worked.
Yeah, I would like to think that that would work on a regular basis, but I...
It's a lot of
otherwise.
Yeah,
a little bit of devil's advocate here. I don't really disagree with anything that was said. Certainly I know. But, I mean, I know that since comment sections came along, I was 100% ignorant how mainstream overt racism was still in my city, in this country, until, I'm 100% ignorant, until comment sections came along.
Huh.
And I still look down at it a lot of times and go like, and in a way, there is a, I think there's a little utility in being reminded that like, oh yeah, this is going on in Squirrel Hill, this is going on in Shady Side, this is not just somewhere else. And I mean, I do feel, I down to the point where I do feel complicit in it, in that, you know, first of all, I'm actually a little surprised to hear that the Trib edits its comments at all, because I'm accustomed to, like, at the Post-Gazette, things seem a little bit more under control in the comments section.
Because they outsource it to a company that's all
they outsource it.
Mm-hmm.
And
well,
to learn that it's even worse than what I'm seeing
If you pay attention, there are... Trip.
Uh-huh.
There are certain stories, and you outlined them, that oftentimes we'll just turn off the comment section before it even posts.
Yes.
Because
we
know what's coming.
Yeah.
Based on past experience of similar stories, we know.
And
just turn it off.
I'm probably contributing to this in a very bad way, because if I see a news story, like let's say that the superintendent of the public schools issue was pretty big one in terms of this. Like, I'll read the headline, I'll be like, oh, I'm sure there's some good information in this news article. I'm going to scroll right down to the bottom and watch the car wreck, because I know there is one. And I just want to see how ugly. Now, is that a bad instinct? Yeah, that's a bad instinct. But I guarantee you there's a lot of people that go down and are like, I want to see the, you know, just how ugly it is.
I think if you open up,
I don't want to see a car wreck with a mark. There have been enough car wrecks across time with black people. You want to talk about the superintendent with black people, with women, with queer people? Like, I'm done with the car wreck, and it is the institution's responsibility to a certain degree. The censorship makes me uncomfortable, but if you're going to provide that platform, it is the responsibility, because. I mean, you are complicit if you're just saying that. I posted the other day, there's like, Hail Hitler, it's the F word, and it says nigger on the wall in the South Side, right?
Yeah.
So I say, yo, this graffiti has been up for 2 months, and no one said anything. I like graffiti. But I don't agree with this messaging, whatever. All these comments were telling me what to do. When I took the action, I made the hashtag, I took the action, right? I took the action as well. The comment section of the post was nothing but people saying, oh, that sucks, sad face, sorry face, just boo-hoo. But there was no action, there was no, I'm just like, come on.
I did see that Dan Gilman responded and said, where is this, I want this gone.
They responded before that. That was great.
Yeah,
they responded before that. But it's you have a responsibility to not just watch the car crash, to go and save a body, to go call someone. You can't just watch the car crash.
And I think there's a little bit of integrity there in how you respond to that, too. I mean, I'm a sarcastic person, and I've been told that sarcasm doesn't come across in writing, which gets me in trouble in places like Twitter and Facebook. But
backslash S is what they're doing nowadays.
I think you know, if you're looking at an article that's titled, you know, you won't believe what these 25 celebrities did on the beach, you know what you're going to get when you're in that comment stream. I think when you're reporting on it, like, hey, Peters Township just raised their taxes, you won't get, you'll get people arguing about whether taxes are good or bad. I think the crazies are maybe minimized, but your experience may be different.
Maybe.
But I do think there's a responsibility on the part of, we mentioned the platform. I don't think it goes to censorship. I think you do need to moderate that, because it quickly descends into chaos. And then it does become that feedback loop where people are just responding to the last five crazy comments.
Right.
And then it goes on and on.
Yeah.
And if you look at the last comment, you don't realize that the article started with a really quick statement on a factual piece. They raised their taxes in this township.
Yeah.
If someone goes into the story about taxes in Peter's Township and says, see, thanks, Obama.
right.
It's done.
Right.
In my experience,
yep.
Right.
Peter's Township is
right.
done. We're on to a different topic, yep. and
there's
got to
be a business out there manufacturing, and it typically like reactionary right wing, like all government is awful, and if we mention any government body for whatever reason, we're just going to say, oh, they're taking your tax. I don't know where it comes from.
It's like an auto reply.
Auto reply.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My favorite comment is Ron Paul 2016. Wherever, just anywhere.
Does that still happen?
It still happens. I love it every time I see it. Every time I see it.
All right, we'll take one more question. I think we got to wrap up soon because we're getting to the end of our time. Go ahead.
So there's a way I can phrase this question that would cause a long conversation, but I'll phrase it in a way that I hope will cause a shorter conversation. So the thing that I know about some of you guys is that you don't necessarily work at big institutions anymore, but you're still doing the thing that you do, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, journalism has become a game of freelancers and a game of, like, working at two different outlets at the same time and all that. Which means that you sort of have two social medias, right? You have the social media that is, like, what the publishing house is actually putting out,
mm-hmm.
and also your own, right? You have your own audiences, right? Like, the audience of the paper in the morning, print, right, and then the audience of, like, your Twitter followers. I was wondering if you guys have discussions about how to have a Twitter that is you, or how to have, like, a social media thing that is you, right, and you're doing the moderation of the comments, because, like, you are your own tiny publishing house, versus newspapers.
I don't know if this answers your question directly. I'll come back to it with a very quick story. I remember being at this nonprofit conference, and there was a woman who was like a nonprofit social media guru, and she was up there talking about how to engage people on social media and how to have this conversation and how to turn that engagement into offline activity. And she's giving this really impassioned speech, and this guy raises his hand, and he's a little bit older guy, raises his hand, and she's like, I'll answer questions in a minute. She keeps going, and she's giving out information like, you really need to be authentic, and you need to have your own voice. And the guy raises his hand again, and she's like, I'll come to your questions at the end. And it's like a half hour in, and she's doing this keynote speech, and this is how you get people to do advocacy and volunteer, and then you get them to donate. And finally, the guy's like exasperated, and he stands up, and he's like, what the fuck is Twitter? Like, what are you talking about? And this, like, she stopped her in her tracks, right? And she's like, whoa. So I would argue that you don't need to have that conversation. I think if you're going to engage in that medium, I think you shouldn't be in that medium just because everyone's in that medium. I think you need to take stock of the conversations that are happening and what you want to use it for and the type of information that you want to put out there and the way you want to put it out there, and that will help you determine maybe and a little bit of understanding of who your audience is, not only demographically, but I think if you look at it on that level, it helps you determine not only where you want to be, but I think your message has to be authentic, but it's going to be contained within the bounds of that structure too.
To some extent, it's creating a character. If there are people out there who only know you by your tweets or your comments in a comment section, they will, if they follow you for very long, create a sense of who you are. And you have to have that in the back of your head anyway as you're putting stuff out there. You know, what are you putting out into the world? Is that the kind of character you want to be known? And that's what keeps ticking in the back of my head.
But do you think that's a different experience than when people would recognize your byline in print?
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
It's so much more of a peek behind the curtain.
Yeah.
And, you know, if your online avatar is really distanced from who you really are, I think that's a problem. If you are creating content that doesn't align with your values or beliefs, that will show very quickly through social media. And it is damn near impossible to separate because you're lending part of yourself. So it's a different environment, but instead of reading your byline, right? Because people get a sense into the process of how you're producing your ideas, your values, your beliefs. And that's why I think social media is all about providing more process view and not like the final product all the time.
Yeah. So, and I would agree with that. And I would say that for me, as a journalist who was formerly with one organization, now is freelance and does many, I've built up a Twitter following because I talked about things that I was interested in and listened to people about what they were interested in. And I wanted to write about, you know, why I sort of went off to do freelance was because I wanted to write about more things that I had, you know, interest in, maybe on a personal level, a professional level. But I think that people who follow me on Twitter follow, I hope, because they're learning something that, you know, as I'm learning, that I'm showing them something that I discovered that I think would be of interest to them. I mean, I'm, you know, you have a personality, I guess, on Twitter. You have to be authentic because in a small town like Pittsburgh, you're going to run into people, to meet people via Twitter, as we did. You know, that we met after we sort of interact on Twitter a bit. And so when you meet someone in person, you should be able to at least recognize, mm-hmm. you know, that person from their tweets. I think that if you're playing a part too much, you're playing a role too much, you know, why bother? You know, and I think that comes back to what is your end goal with getting a personality, having a brand. You know, I think journalists hate that term, having a brand. But I think if you're authentic and you're doing work that you are standing behind, it's just another manifestation of being that authentic voice, you know, that trusted source of information. You're just being more accessible to people in maybe a little bit more one-on-one way than we have been in the past, if that makes sense. So I guess we can close it on that note. I'll get the last word. And thanks, everyone, so much for coming tonight. And thanks for our panelists. I think this was a really great discussion and hopefully enlightening. And, you know, you can, you know, come to PodCamp in August. It's going to be a lot of diverse sessions, a lot of, you know, great things to be learned, and hopefully, you know, we can continue this conversation on Twitter and elsewhere going forward. So thanks very much, and thanks so much for Work Hard for sponsoring us and letting us have their space tonight. Good?